इनकम टैक्स रजिस्ट्रेशन प्रोसीजर, एग्जेम्पशन ऑफ इनकम, एक्यूमुलेशन एंड इन्वेस्टमेंट, फॉरफीचर ऑफ एग्जेम्पशन, बिजनेस एक्टिविटी एंड एटीजी, दीज आर द सिक्स थिंग्स दैट वी विल लुक एट. फर्स्ट रजिस्ट्रेशन प्रोसीजर. नाउ विद इन वन ईयर ऑफ द इनकॉर्पोरेशन ऑफ द रजिस्ट्रेशन ऑफ द ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, अप्लाई इन फॉर्म 10A टू द कमिश्नर ऑफ इनकम टैक्स और डायरेक्टर ऑफ इनकम टैक्स एग्जेम्पशंस. सो देयर इज अ फॉर्म इन विच यू नीड टू अप्लाई टू द इनकम टैक्स कमिश्नर एंड यू हैव टू अटैच द कॉपी ऑफ द ओरिजिनल इंस्ट्रूमेंट अंडर विच द एनपीओ वाज रजिस्टर्ड. नॉर्मली वी डोंट अटैच द ओरिजिनल इंस्ट्रूमेंट, बट वट वी डू इज दैट द कॉपी फोटोकॉपी इज अटैच एंड दिस इज वेरीफाइड. सो लेटर ऑन we go and show it to the income tax commissioner to say that this is the original. Two copies of the accounts of three previous years to be attached were applicable. So sometimes, you know, this is another problem that in many of the workshops what we have seen is the NGOs have not even registered with the FCRA for 20-25 years. And FCRA, income tax. So income tax. Now the problem is that if they go to the income tax department and start registering, they will require 3 years accounts, and so they will put a demand of last 3 years with penalty and everything else. So that is a sort of a catch-22 situation, and that needs to be fought at the higher levels. There have been court cases where the courts have allowed that if you are allowing registration, so income tax department will allow you registration prospectively. It cannot give you registration retrospectively, right? So what happens is that, but you have, when you file your 10A, you have to file for last 3 years. So from 3 years, you'll pick up the income and then put tax on it and put penalty on it and interest and all that, and it comes to a substantial amount. However, if this issue is fought in the courts and there are cases where the income tax department was forced to allow even from a retrospective effect, but the law doesn't allow, so commissioner of income tax cannot allow from a retrospective effect, so prospectively. So it's better in the first year itself we get an exemption. Time limit is within 1 year of the date of incorporation of the organization.
So in the High Court,
it didn't go to the Supreme Court, but in the High Court has allowed, and then the department didn't go to the Supreme Court. So basically the issue is that the law doesn't allow, so CIT cannot allow. The CIT will only allow prospectively. So if say from today onwards you are registered, but then immediately he is also under the law even to charge this tax and penalty and all that, right? So then once you fight it in the higher courts, then the courts allow that. Okay, so 6 months from the date of application, the income tax commissioner has to dispose of the application. Now the issues are that, okay, the opportunity of being heard has to be given, and there is appeal possible against rejection. Suppose the commissioner rejects, then you can go in appeal. But there is no clarity if no order is passed within the time limit. So there is no penalty at the end of the department if they do not pass the order on time. Normally it has not happened. I have never seen that the 12A registration has, the order has not been passed.
The judgment that came only last week, which says it's only a directory clause about this. That means if it is delayed beyond 6 months, it's merely a direction. It's not mandatory.
Correct.
Upon the CIT to dispose application.
Correct.
Within 6 months.
Correct.
Just last week I read it.
Okay.
In one of the
okay.
reviews.
Okay. Okay. So that is about registration. Now we come to the part of exemption. Types of income are contribution to corpus of the trust, other contribution or donation, income from business activity, capital gains. So these are the four types of income that normally an NGO can have. One is that corpus donation, the other is other donation, grants, contributions, income from business activity, and capital gains. Right? So, corpus grant, corpus donation, it comes with a direction from the donor. This we have seen yesterday. Right? So, the donor will say that we are contributing this for the corpus of the organization, and that need not, that doesn't fall under the 85% application clause. So you can retain 100% of it within the organization. You don't have to spend anything. Secondly, other contribution by donations and all that, grants, donations, that comes under the clause of 85%. So you have to spend 85% of it. But we'll see how that also, what are the clauses on, under that. Income from business activities. According to the new law, in 2008, the section 2 subsection 15 was amended. What is section 2 subsection 15? It talks about charitable purpose. So charitable purpose said relief to the poor, education, medical, in 2008, any other activity of general public utility. These are the four things that were said in the law. Now, when the amendment came in 2008, it said the first three is okay, they can do commercial activity, but if you are an any other activity of general public utility, you cannot do any commercial activity. Commercial activity was banned under the fourth limb. Now we must understand the income tax law. Unfortunately, section 215, or when unfortunately when section 12A, when you get a registration, when there's a certificate on 12A, it does not tell you in the certificate which limb you are registered, whether you are a relief to the poor organization or whether. So that is all determined in your objective of the organization. So that left a big space where there will be a lot of confusion and counterclaims. So the when the assessment happens, you have to really prove that you are in one of the limbs or in the following on the residual limb. There were a lot of discussions in 2009. I think two more limbs were added. One is preservation of monuments of historic interest and environment. So four limbs became six limbs now. But the issue remained that organizations who fall on the sixth limb, which is any other activity of general public utility, still they cannot do business activity beyond 25 lakhs. Sorry, they could not do business activity. Then they brought it, said, okay, you can, then a lot of Gandhian organizations, they started saying that Gandhi only was said that, you know, you sell khadi. And how can you say that, you know, don't do any business activity? So then they said, okay, you can do up to 10 lakhs. Then there was a lot of other organizations also started shouting. Now it has become 25 lakhs. Minimum amount to be applied. So as we said, 85% of the income has to be applied for charitable purpose. So what happens if you are not able to apply 85%? The law says that if you are not able to apply 85%, you can set aside the amount which you could not apply, spend, then you can apply it next 5 years for the same purpose. And if you are not able to apply within 5 years, in the sixth year it will become taxable. So there is an option of 5 years. Accumulation, 15% can be accumulated indefinitely. This is what section 11(1)(a) says. Treatment when income is derived but not received. This is if you receive the money in, let's say, March, then you can deem it can be deemed to be received in the next year and spent. Unable to utilize 85% of income applied, apply for accumulation 5 years. And accumulated amounts have to be invested as per section 11(5). This we have already seen. exemption will be withdrawn if applied for purposes other than for which accumulated. So if you have accumulated it for that purpose, it has been spent for that purpose. If you do not spend for that purpose, then the exemption will be withdrawn. Investment does not remain in the mode of 11.5. So if you are investing in some other modes, then also you lose your exemption and not utilized within the period of accumulation. Now this is important, inter-charity donation out of accumulated funds is not possible. So you cannot transfer it to another NGO after accumulating, you have to spend it in your organization. Section 13, we are talking about interested parties. If the income is not applied for the benefit of public, 1A. If income is applied for the benefit of any particular religious community or caste. If applied for the benefits of persons specified in section 13.3, all that board members and relatives and so on. And if the funds are applied in modes other than those specified in section 11.5, or invested, not applied. So, section 13.3, who are the interested persons? Author or founder of the organization, person who has made substantial contribution to the trust. If somebody who is made a substantial contribution and becomes a beneficiary, so that is not allowed. You cannot be the donor and the beneficiary at the same time. Any trustee or manager, and a relative of such author, person, founder, member, trustee or manager. Any concern which persons mentioned have substantial interest. So these are the interested parties and section 13.3 says. Now business activity, charitable purpose, this we have already seen. Relief to the poor, education, medical relief, preservation of environment including watershed, forest, wildlife, preservation of monument or places, preservation of artistic or historical interest, and advancement of any other object of general public utility. So, you cannot, the organization cannot do business, only it is allowed to do incidental business activity. It is not that you can do any business. You have to do incidental to the objective of the organization. So 10 lakhs, now it has become 25 lakhs, this we have also discussed. Condition for claiming the exemption, business should be incidental to the attainment of the objectives. Separate books of accounts have to be maintained, section 11.4. So this is about, broadly, about the income tax. And in 80G, organization has to apply in the form 10G for 80G. Documents to be enclosed, copy of the income tax registration certificate. Activities since inception of or last 3 years, whichever is less, copies of the audited accounts from the inception or last 3 years. Should not have any income which are not exempt. For example, business income. I mean, it should be under 12A, that is the most important thing, then only 80G will come, otherwise 80G will not be given. The donation received under section 80G should not be used for such business. The bylaws should not contain any clause which is other than charitable. The organization should not be working for the benefit of any particular religious community or caste. If that is there, then 80G registration normally is not available, even though in Delhi, some gurdwaras and churches have got 80G as a special status. For a cathedral church of redemption.
But that's because they have archaeological and artistic importance.
Yes, so they have, they get it. Maintains regular books of accounts, receipt and expenditure, properly registered in India. If donation of more than 10,000 in cash, then 80G privilege will not be available. If an organization was holding a valid registration of 80G as on 1/10/2009, then the registration is permanent. So you don't, earlier there used to be time for registration of 3 years, 5 years. but now it is one time. So if your organization had a valid registration on 1st October 2009, then it is permanent. And if now you apply, then it is only one time.